Welcome to Trial Site News Roundup. Today we'll be taking a close look at the manufacturer of Stromectol and Mectizan, which are branded versions of ivermectin. Merck is challenging safety and validity of all ivermectin studies for COVID-19, despite having donated billions of doses to the less developed world to fight parasites, along with the accumulating positive data of ivermectin against COVID-19. Then we'll talk about the World Health Organization's Dr. Maria van Kerkhove, who says that ivermectin has shown promising results in some trials. And then we'll finally take a brief look at the Bulgarian randomized double-blind placebo-controlled ivermectin study, which shows positive results against COVID-19. And so, from Trial Site News, I'm Adrian, and the News Roundup starts now. A February 4th press release from Merck is raising more questions about why research money is not going to ivermectin and why this seemingly effective drug is so underutilized, even in North American research. Now, in the statement, Merck, one of the great pharmaceutical companies and manufacturers of the Stromectol Mectizan brand versions of ivermectin, claimed that there is no evidence that ivermectin works for COVID-19 and that there is a concerning lack of safety data in the majority of studies, suggesting that the drug may be unsafe. Now, concern number two is odd, given that Merck has proudly donated billions of doses of ivermectin to fight river blindness. Now, on its website, Merck boasts that its own Dr. William Campbell first suggested the use of ivermectin for river blindness in the late 1970s, and that from 1987 to today, Merck has committed to donating as much as needed for as long as needed to eliminate river blindness. The firm noted that the ivermectin program reached more than 300 million people in the affected areas annually, with more than 4 billion treatments donated since 1987. And according to the August 2020 version of the NIH's COVID-19 treatment guidelines, ivermectin has demonstrated an excellent safety profile in past use. The Merck press release goes on to intricately detail ivermectin's potential adverse reactions. But in the context of the National Institutes of Health's view and the efficacy issues touched on, this focus has an element of strategic scaremongering. So the question then is, why? Could it be because not only did they just acquire a company for $425 million to develop a novel COVID-19 treatment, but they also recently received $356 million from the government to support the effort? Well, let's take a look. So, we here at Trial Site News have been chronicling the use of ivermectin in COVID-19 studies after the University of Monash lab culture study revealed that the generic drug destroyed SARS-CoV-2 fivefold in just over 48 hours in a lab. Now, since April, we have documented well over 36 studies that indicate a strong efficacy signal. From Bangladesh, Egypt, Iraq, and India, physician research groups emerged to conduct meta-analysis, which means a statistical analysis that combines the result of multiple clinical trials. Now, this class of research helps when there are multiple studies addressing the same question, noting that each individual underlining study reporting measurements certainly includes some degree of error and potential for bias. The first group to take on the growing number of ivermectin studies targeting COVID-19 was the Frontline COVID-19 Critical Care Alliance, led by Drs. Paul Merrick and Pierre Curie. Now, their meta-analysis was followed by two comparable efforts in the United Kingdom, one by Dr. Andrew Hill, affiliated with the University of Liverpool, and the other by Dr. Tess Lowry, with the evidence-based medicine consultancy LTD. These groups and their meta-analysis and over 50 studies conducted worldwide completely conflict with the Merck press release. So now let's move on and address the newfound concern for lack of safety data that Merck espouses in their press release. Ivermectin has been used for decades now, as I mentioned, to fight parasites. The World Health Organization has listed it as an essential medicine since 2019. And as I noted earlier, Merck themselves have donated billions of doses of this medicine. And then there is the opinion by one of the world's top experts in the ivermectin field, Dr. Carlos Shakur, who says that the drug is safe. He said that when used for the current indications at the currently approved doses, ivermectin is a very safe drug. To date, more than 3 billion treatments have been distributed in the context of the Mectizan donation program, along with an excellent safety profile. Most adverse reactions are mild, transitory, and associated with parasite death rather than with the drug itself. We also recently interviewed Dr. Femi Babaloa from Nigeria, who has led the IverCOVID study. Dr. Babaloa shared that Nigeria is perhaps the country with the most ivermectin use in the world, with about 80 million people who have taken it over the past 25 years to combat parasites, again, as part of the Mectizan donation program. Now, he shared with us at Trial Site News that the drug is quite safe. So now then, let's look at economic realities here. Which then takes us back to Merck again. They recently conceded failure with their vaccine initiative and are now eyeing the market that remdesivir has already captured, which led to Gilead capturing nearly $3 billion in revenue in just several months of its release. Merck identified potential products with a couple of candidates known as EIDD-2801 and MK-7110, formerly known as CD24FC. The latter products came via a recent acquisition for $425 million of the biotech firm Oncoimmune. We also reported that Merck received $356 million from the U.S. government's Department of Health and Human Services for its ongoing research targeting COVID-19. Securing somewhere between 60,000 to 100,000 doses of the experimental product from Oncoimmune. Now, according to Merck, MK-7110 is a potentially first-in-class investigational recombinant fusion protein that modulates the inflammatory response to SARS-CoV-2, principally by targeting a novel immune pathway checkpoint. Now, interim results from one small phase 3 study revealed a 50% reduction in the risk of death. So, Merck's utter and complete dismissal of dozens of legitimate study results worldwide, combined with the growing data points indicating some level of efficacy, could give many pause. Merck has serious economic pressure to produce a therapy targeting COVID-19, evidenced by the $425 million cash acquisition of Oncoimmune and the shortly thereafter $356 million payment by the U.S. government for advanced development, manufacturing, and procurement. And so, it appears that Merck had to make a cold, hard business decision. It is unfortunate, then, that they felt compelled to put down so many others' research, not to mention the safety and benefits of their own product. But that's something that they will have to live with. Like the Merck we once knew, the one that gave away billions of doses of ivermectin to the developing world for the sake of humanity, we continue to look for a great company brand, one that stands for compelling values, ethics, and global health for all. For the next story on the Roundup, we're going to talk about the World Health Organization, which held a media briefing and included Dr. Maria van Kerkhove to discuss the potential of ivermectin as a generic drug, demonstrating some promise as a treatment for at least mild early-onset COVID-19. Now, Dr. Kerkhove, a technical lead of this global organization's COVID-19 response and expert in emerging diseases and zoonosis, reported that she is carefully monitoring clinical trials and noted that some of these studies soon to conclude may trigger the World Health Organization to carefully review, analyze, and describe a recommendation in the weeks to come. She also shared that they currently have data on 1,500 study patients from 11 studies, but that ultimately there could be data involving up to 7,000 patients from a total of 56 studies. She emphasized that the underlying studies vary in quality and that the World Health Organization factors that element into their ultimate recommendations. A steering committee will carefully look at the updated data to consider any change in guidance. Dr. Kerkhove shared that this process is, in fact, expedited. However, she emphasized the incredibly comprehensive review that will ultimately be shared with the public. So, a European Union-based double-blind study, placebo-controlled phase 2 clinical trial involving ivermectin in 100 patients with mild COVID-19 recently produced results for the world. Now, this study was based in Bulgaria, and the clinical trial was organized after scientists there learned of the data revealing that the drug blocks penetration of SARS-CoV-2's transport protein into the cell nucleus, and thus inhibits or hinders replication, which could possibly be of use in combating this pandemic. Now, this study is led by a company called Hoove Pharma, which makes the ivermectin-based product known as Hoovemex. The study involved 3-milligram tablets at 12 hospitals under a protocol approved by the Executive Agency for Medicines in alignment with European Union and national regulatory guidelines. Although not a large study and no material mortality rate data, this study appears to be the first complete double-blind placebo-controlled ivermectin study conducted in the European Union. Now, as reported in economic.bg, the results reveal that the study drug accelerated the clearance of the virus, as evidenced by reading of RT-PCR tests by day 3 and 4, post-treatment start date. The investigators also observed marked improvement in patient clinical condition for those in the study drug arm based on the World Health Organization 9-category ordinal scale. As compared to placebo, the participants receiving the ivermectin-based drug fared better, statistically, than those in the placebo group. Interestingly, these study sponsors observed that the ivermectin-based drug appeared associated with the suppression and normalization of important inflammation biomarkers, considered by many scientists as an important indicator of pathological processes associated with COVID-19 disease progression. The sponsors shared with the Bulgarian press that the study drug on average started to make its positive impact felt. And that, my friends, brings this episode to a close. Thank you so much for joining us today. As always, we appreciate each and every one of you for being here with us. From Trial Site News, I'm Adrian, and this has been an episode of the News Roundup. I'll see you all next time.